So now again, here we have this diagram, pressure dependent here on the y-axis, the temperature. Here we have the composition between albite and autoclase. But this experiment was done at 2,000 bars, and this experiment was done at 5,000 bars. If we are increasing the pressure, then our solid liquid curves become moved downward, and then you can produce here a feldspar with this composition. Whereas if we have a lower lower pressure, then we will produce here only one alkali feldspar. And if we are running to this curve, then here we will produce an albite, and along this curve we will produce an autoclase. So what you should have in mind then, that is that with increasing the temperature or increasing the pressure, then you will produce an one alkali feldspar or this field of the two feldspars. Here again, we have here the albite, and here we have the autoclase that was done here, also at one bar only. Here on the y-axis, you have the temperature. Then we have here liquid, we have here a doisite and liquid. Here we have alkali feldspar. Yes, then you have it there, you can make a mixture. But as soon as you are running on this curve, then you will produce here either an autoclase, or along this curve, you will produce here an albite. Here at high temperature, you will produce a xanidine, that is the high temperature feldspar. Then here at lower temperatures, you will produce the autoclase, and at very low temperature, you will produce the microcline. So at the microcline. All three of them are K feldspars, but they have the different crystallographic symmetry. So here on this side you have the different albites. You have the high albite, the intermediate albite, and low albite. Here you have the mono albite. So when they have also the same chemical composition, but different symmetry. So we did this now a lot of times, or I mentioned it a lot of times, that we have always, with changing pressure and temperature conditions, we are changing the crystallographic symmetry, and or we are changing also the mineral chemistry. So as it is written here we are dealing with a triclinic symmetry, and here we are dealing with a monoclinic symmetry. So now, in the diagram before, we saw just now that only our crystallographic symmetry will change, but here in our next diagram, we have in the plagioclase solid solution, and that means or shows us how the chemistry changes with increasing or decreasing pressure. So here we have the example of using the anorthite for the plagioclases. So, and here we have our albite. And here we have our K feldspar. No, we have the anorthite. So, that is the anorthite on this side. And the albite is on this side, and at high temperatures we are forming an anorthite, yeah? That is here at 1550 degrees Celsius, and at lower temperatures at about 1100 degrees Celsius, we are forming an albite. So in this field here we have liquid, then in this green shaded field we have the melt and the plagioclase. That means if we are running along this curve, we are producing then here in this field the first plagioclases, and here in this light blue colored field we have the we have then the plagioclase solid solution. That means we have here a solid wall. So and if we have a melt of this composition, yeah, then we are running along this curve till we are running here just till we are reaching this liquid curve. Then we are going here, and then we are running around here, and then we are getting here and plagioclase which contains 50% of albite and 50% of anorthite. So if we have a melt of this composition, we are going around here till we are reaching the curve, going then here to our solid curve. This here is the liquidus, this here is the solidus, then we are running here, going here, running around there, and then we are going down. Yep. So this you know by now, we have done it also a lot of times. We have here the mesosilicate, these are the single tetrahedrons. We have the sorbisilicates, where we have two tetrahedrons connected to each other. We have the cyclosilicates, we have the phyllosilicates, these are the micas. We have the pyroxenes, which are single chains. So and then we have the double chain silicates, and these are the amphiboles. Yeah? So, but we have done this before in detail.
That we don't need anymore. This one I saw, I think I showed it to you as well. So that is just a picture from the mantle structure. But anyway, again,
we have here at the top, we have the oceanic crust, which consists of basalt and gabbro. And that is about 7 kilometers thick. So we know we have then the conductive mantle, that is the lithosphere. In this case, it is the oceanic lithosphere. We have here a layer of hard sphugite consisting of 80% of olivine and 20% of OBX. We know we have the lherzolites, containing of 60% of olivine, 40% of pyroxenes, and we can have a little bit garnet. Then we have here the plate boundary. Below we have the asthenosphere, and then in the asthenosphere we have the pyrolite, and the pyrolite is nearly of lherzolitic in composition or composition. So then we have here another boundary at a depth of 400 k's. Then we are running in the upper mantle. Here we have the transition from olivine into metaspinel, and here we have pyroxene goes to metaspinel and sclisovite. And sclisovite I showed you by now also. That is this high pressure quartz. And here we are running then at the depth of about 660 kilometers, we are running then in the lower mantle. So, and in the lower mantle we have gamma spinel, and it goes to perovskite and periclase.
The perovskite has the same chemical composition like an orthopyroxene, and the periclase, that is the MgO. So now something new.
So here we have the basalt tetrahedron. So and I told you that olivine never occurs together with quartz, and also the feldspar tonites never occurring with quartz. So in this basalt tetrahedron here on this side, we have a basalt containing of quartz, orthopyroxene, klein and kleinopyroxene. Yeah, that is this one. Then on this plane we have a basalt containing of orthopyroxene, plagioclase and clinopyroxene. So in this plane we have then basalt which consists of olivine, plagioclase, clinopyroxene, yeah? So and these are the basalts which we will see then next week, not the next week, which we will find in Corbu, yeah? We have this orchite plagioclase, we have this orchite bearing basalts, and this orchite bearing basalts, these are olivine basalts, they are silica undersaturated, and most of the rocks are in Corbu, which you will see them during the field trip, are of this composition. So, but here on Viti Levu, you can also find basalts which contain olivine, clinopyroxene, and nepheline. Yeah, nepheline, that is this feldspar to me. So if you have nepheline in the system, then you don't have plagioclase here in the system. So and these are the different basalts, and therefore we are using this tetrahedron, which you can find at the, or which you can produce at the middle ocean ridges, yeah? You can produce a quartz bearing basalt or an olivine bearing basalt. But both both olivine and quartz level occur together. Yeah? So, and here on this plane, or on this plane here, we have silica saturation, that means we have silica in excess. So in this plane here, we have silica under saturation. If we are producing at the middle ocean ridge a basalt, yeah, then we are calling this MOG that stands for middle ocean ridge basalt. So and if you are producing a basalt that is by partial melting, then we are producing a residuum. So we have one melt. So we have one melt that is, for example, this pyrolite at the middle ocean ridge. So here we have our middle ocean ridge melt, that is this pyrolite. So when there is an N morb, and an N morb that is just a normal basalt, yes, that is a depleted one. So and then we have here partial melting will take place. We are producing here at the top then our basalt here, yeah. So and below you are producing the residuums. So in the residuums, this is then the garnet lherzolite. And this garnet lherzolite you are producing here. That is the garnet. Lherzolite. So in the above you are producing then the hard sphogite. So here above you have then the hard sphogite, and then you are producing some olivine nodules, and these all olivine nodules, these are then the dunites, yeah? So that means you have here one melt, and for one part of this melt you are producing these basalts at the top and the gabbros, and from the other part of the melt, these are then the residuums, you are producing then your material which you can find
in the mantle slab, yeah? So, and these are the garnet hairs, so like olivine nodules, which are all the dunites and the Harzburgites, yeah? So, and that is now a simplified picture, because we will do this later. Every of these peridotites, I mean the garnet hairs, like the olivine nodules and the Harzburgite, they have also a coil in basalt, yeah? So that means, we will see this then also in coral, there you will find this. Garnet lyrsolites, and you will find Harzburgites, and you will find olivine nodules, and they are pure as xenolites, that means inclusion, and these xenolites may be of this size, some are bigger, some are smaller, they are within the basalt, yeah? So, but they have been formed from the same parent melt. So when if you have a melt, you are forming always, on the other hand, you are forming a basalt or an andesite, whatever you want, and then you are forming also a residuum, yeah? So, and then that is then how it looks like in nature. We have here the ocean ridge, and then we have the ocean basalt, and here we have a continent. So, and here we have a fertile peridotite. So, and then we have here different stability fields. Here we have a depleted peridotite, here we have a fertile peridotite. A fertile peridotite has then, for example, more potassium group elements in the belt, yeah? And potassium group elements, this is then barium, strontium, rubidium, potassium, these are the potassium group elements. They are only in tracers inside, but therefore we have here a fertile peridotite, and here we have a depleted one. So that here, if we are talking about this stuff, then it's also depleted. Then we can subdivide our peridotites into plagioclase peridotites, spinel peridotites, which means we have here a spinel lyrsolite, here in the fertile part we have here a spinel lyrsolite, we have here a garnet lyrsolite, and if we have if we are sitting here on the depleted side, then we have here the plagioclase peridotite, that is then a peridotite which is formed at lower pressures, yeah, because the pressure goes with the depth. Then we have here the spinel peridotite, and here we have the garnet peridotite, yeah. So, and these peridotites and lyrsolites, which you will find when you are in the field trip, they are spinel and plagioclase peridotites, yeah? So that means these mantle nodules and coral, they are formed in a depth of about here, yeah? Because some of these nodules, they contain plagioclase and spinel. So, and some of them contain only spinel, then they are formed somewhere here. So, and then one has to find out if they are fertile or depleted, and therefore we are left and powder them and make some bulk of chemical measurements. Yes, this we had by now also a lot of times, yes. These are the olivine normative rocks in the MSH subsystem. So, and I told you this also before, if we have an Harzburgite formed somewhere here, yeah, and then it is lying around here,
and we have then some faults and cracks in the oceanic crust, and these faults and cracks in the oceanic crust can go up or down to a depth of about 50 kilometers. So that is then about here and here and here, and most of them are vertical, yeah? That means perpendicular to the middle ocean ridge. And then hydration will take place. And if you have hydration at low temperatures, here of about 200 degrees Celsius, you are forming then from your enstatite and forsterite and chrysotile. Here at a little bit higher temperatures, you are forming antigorite and leucite. So, and if you are forming about higher temperatures, then it depends how close it is to the middle ocean ridge and how deep the crack is, because you are warming up the stuff from below, yeah? So then you have here antigorite and forsterite, here you have then the talc and the forsterite, anthophyllite and forsterite, and here you have the enstatite and the forsterite, which is then actually the hartsburgite, yeah? So, and if you are running here into a subduction, here you have the continental crust again, yeah? So, and here you are running into a subduction zone, you are subducting the material, then your cracks or your hydrated stuff becomes once more dehydrated along such a medium pressure temperature pass, and then you are forming somewhere here, again, the forsterite and the enstatite, and from your hydrated stuff or due to dehydration, you will then form here again melt, which will rise up, yeah? So it's always a game of hydration and dehydration. These parts of the slab, which are not hydrated, yeah? They will just remain as they are. So here we have some suggestions about our mantle composition. Here we have our mantle composition, that is the dunite and the hartsburgite in the MSH system. So, and then you can write down following reactions, yeah? So, and we have done this now also a lot of times, and Dean has done this exercise with you in class, yeah? Drawing the triangle and then writing down these reactions. Yes, you have done that, yeah? You have already done the shiny part, that's okay. So that is so far here now, and then you can also use again your method with your hand, just putting the hand there, and then you can write down the reaction, and that this was just projected on a 2D plane. So here, that is now the stability field of our aluminous phase in the lherzolite. So, and here we have this, on this side we have just melt, yeah? That is a pyrolite melting curve, and that is pyrolite, that is just this melt here. Then you are extracting from your melt the basalt or the basaltic melt, and then dependent on the depth here, you are forming then your different lherzolites. Here you have the plagioclase lherzolite, the spinel lherzolite, and the garnet lherzolite. So, and I told you these lherzolites, which you will find during the field trip, some of them containing plagioclase and spinel, so and that means you are running then around along this curve, then you have just to do the measurements of the olivines, the pyroxenes, and everything else what is inside, and then one can calculate the temperature, and from your microscopic observations, you can see the plagioclase and the spinel, and then you are somewhere here, and they are formed at a temperature of about 1000 degrees, at the pressure of about 10 kilobars, and if you have 10 kilobars, then they have peaked up in a depth of about 30 kilometers. So in this basaltic melt, which will, or this, they brought up to the surface by the volcanic eruption, and this basaltic melt was formed at about the same depth. So, and why we have then formed such new rocks, such new basaltic rocks, and we are sending our basaltic rock, I mean the basalt and the gabbro at the top, here in such a collision zone, in a subduction zone, then we are producing from our igneous rocks metamorphic rocks. Yes, we have done this now also a lot of times. Yeah? That is the rock cycle. So, and if hydration occurs here in the oceanic crust, yeah, at the top, then we are forming then a subgreen schist, for example, or we can also find a form of green schist. So if we are sending it then along in this subduction zone, then we are making here a steep PT pass, so that means we are forming the blue schists and later on eclogites, yeah. So that is the typical PT pass for a subduction zone, whereas if we have a continent collision, then we have a medium pressure, medium temperature PT pass. We are running here then through the subgreen schist, the green schist, the amphibolite up to the granulite, yeah? So and if we have a contact metamorphic event, like it is then here, for example, we have here the rise up of this melt, and this melt becomes stuck here, and then we have here the surrounding rocks, they become heated up, and that is then the contact metamorphic event, and such contact metamorphic events taking place at very low pressures but high temperatures. Yeah, then you have another PT pass, and this PT pass goes like this. So but one can have different PT passes depending on the geotectonic setting. You can also produce such a PT pass, and then you are sending it down to depth. If we are melting something, then it is very important, and I told you this now also a lot of times, if we have a dry melt or a wet melt. So if we have a lot of water available, then a granite will melt at temperatures here along this curve at 750 degrees Celsius. Here it will start to melt, yeah? So that is the slickvidus curve, and here we have then the water-saturated solidus. Or if we are heating it up here, then here it will start to melt. Here we have the melt and solid material, and here at this curve, our granite here is totally molten, yeah? So and here we have the dry solidus and the dry liquidus. That means if we have less volatiles available, then our granite will start much later to it will start at much higher temperatures to melt, yeah? Here we have the dry solidus, here we have the liquid and solid material, and here we have the dry liquidus. So then you can see that the melting behavior of a granite varies over, let us say, 300 degrees degrees Celsius here more than if you are checking here the liquidus from here to here, it varies over 400 degrees Celsius, the melting behavior, depending on the volatile concentration. Here we have the same diagram, but just for the basalt. The basalts, they are melting at higher temperatures. Here we have the water-saturated solidus. Then we have here a solid basaltic rock. Here we are producing the first melt. And here we have the dry liquidus and the dry solidus, yeah? Or if you are just going back to our triangle, here we have the albite, and here we have the kieferspar, and here we have quartz. So, and here that is then an eutecticum, and an eutecticum, you know this from our diagram, from our melt diagrams before, at this eutecticum, we have a melt, and this melt contains then quartz, sodic feldspar, and potassium feldspar. So, and this here is the pressure dependent, and here we have 500 bar, 1000 bar, 3000 bar, and 5000 bar.
So, any question? just wait a few seconds, I'm looking for something.
Yes.
So I will just give you now an example or an overview from my own work. Why we are doing all this stuff, and how is it then related in practice with the theory from all these diagrams what I have shown you before. So that is now an example from my own studies, and there I did some metamorphic petrology and circuit geochronology of high-grade rocks from Tanzania. So and that is an example for crustal recycling of Archean and Paleoproterozoic material during the Pan-African Orogen. So what means this metamorphic petrology? You know this by now, that means just that we are calculating the pressure and the temperature when the rock is formed. So then circuit geochronology, that means we are using minerals, and there I'm using circuit always to date the rock. Yeah, in circuit you have a little bit uranium inside, and then you have the decay from uranium to lead, and therefore you can then calculate how old these rocks are. So in crustal recycling, that means we have a subduction zone, or we have a continent-continent collision zone. So in the Archean and Paleoproterozoic material, that means we are dealing with rocks, Archean rocks, and Archean rocks, they are between 2,500 and about 2,000, and in this case between 2,500 and 2,900 million years old. And then we have paleoproterozoic material, at least in this case, between 1,800 and 2,000 million years old. And this material was recycled, that means we had a metamorphic event during Pan-African time, and Pan-African time that is between about in the 500 and 700 million years ago. So, and if you have Archean and Paleoproterozoic material, then we are talking here about igneous rocks, and these igneous rocks has become metamorphosed later on. So, and here you have an elephant, and these elephants are everywhere in Tanzania, and they are standing on the road, and if the elephant swept up the ears, yeah, then you have to be careful because then they are attacking you. So that is now a picture at first
from the continent constellation, where why we had supercontinent Gondwana. Yes, you know by now, I did it with you in ES106, we had always the formation of supercontinents and the breakup of supercontinents. So, and that was then supercontinent Gondwana, and there was South America together with Africa, yes, this opening here that starts 130 million years ago. And here we have Antarctica, Australia, India, and here is So, and here we have then these old shields, the Congo, the Kalahari, San Francisco, Amazon, West Africa, and here we have in red, these red lines, they are marking the Mozambique Belt in East Africa, and that is a huge orogen that is actually the biggest orogen in the world. So here that is then again Tanzania, and everywhere between these old cratons, you have the mobile belts. So in these mobile belts, these are these belts where we have collision or we have rifting. But anyway, we are in these belts, we have always the occurrence of metamorphism, and that means recycling of rocks. But at first you have to replace the rocks, and then you can recycle them. So that is the geological map which I made that time. So here you have the old Tanzania craton, here you have these granulites, and these granulites, these are the rocks which I have studied there. So and then you have here another old mobile belt, you have here the Usagaran and here the Ubangian. And these are older mobile belts, they are about 2,000 million years old. So and then I made two cross-sections. I drove one time from Dar es Salaam over Morogoro to Dodoma, and one time from Dar es Salaam here to Iringa. So and there I just drove around, and then I picked up all the rock samples. So Anil will give you then also some maps for the Koro field trip, and also GPS, that the rock samples which you are sampling, you can then just write in your map from where you got them. So and there, this is the way how it looks like there in Tanzania. You have these strongly folded rocks, yeah? So and these rocks become so folded because of collision. So and here is a scale that is Professor Heukes from the University of Graz. So how does it look like in the schematical scene? We have here a collision, yeah? One plate is moving beneath the other plate. Then you have here the time one, that is this time when your material was actually produced. There the clock starts. Then here we are subducting the stuff, and then we have time two. And if we are going from here to here, what happens? We are increasing the pressure and we are increasing the temperature, yeah? That is then like this. Yes, here we have time one. And here we have steady state geotherm, and steady state geotherm, that means your rock sample has the same pressure and temperature condition as the surrounding material. So, but here you are bringing your rock sample then out of equilibrium. So, because you are heating, the temperature will increase and the pressure will increase, yeah? So that means the first metamorphic reaction will start, yeah? So because your rock sample is trying always to get at the same temperature and the pressure condition as the surrounding material, yeah? So and then mineral reaction takes place, and that means
these hydrous minerals will just dehydrate, yeah? And some other minerals, they will change their crystallographic structure or symmetry.
So then we have time three, then we have the maximum pressure is reached. So that is here the maximum pressure, that is here. So then we are moving from here to here, and what happens? Our temperature will increase, yeah? Because I mean it becomes heated up from below. Then we are going from here to here, and then at this point here we have then the maximum temperature, yeah? So and your rock sample is always trying to get at the same temperature and pressure condition as the surrounding material, yeah? So and if we are sitting at this point T4 and our rock sample has now reached the same pressure and temperature condition as the surrounding material, then we are talking about peak metamorphism. And we are talking about that our rock sample is now in equilibrium, yeah? I mentioned this to you before as well. So, but now, our rock sample is sitting here. So, and we are sitting here. So, and we cannot go there and pick it up, yeah? So, that means we have to wait. And we have here to wait, here we have a time of 30 million years, here we have 20 million years, then after 10 million years it is there, and maybe after another 10 million years it is at the surface. And that is, if our sample comes up due to lithostatic pressure, yeah? So that means our rock units here at the top becoming removed, and that is just due to weathering, yeah? So and if we are weathering all the stuff, then the parts from below can come up to the top, yeah? So and then we can walk around and sample again. So on Poro, when you are picking up your mantle nodules, we have not to wait so long, yeah? Because these mantle nodules were just came to the Earth's surface via volcanic eruption, yeah? So then it works faster, then it is just a question of a few hours or days, yeah? So if they are coming up with a kimberlite eruption, we know these eruptions these are these eruptions which are very fast. They are not, this kimberlitic band is not melting through the crust, but it is just using a pass, that means a crack or a former volcanic pipe, and then they are much faster and they are running from a depth of about 200 kilometers to the Earth's surface within a couple of minutes, or 10, 20 or 30 minutes. So, but in Tanzania, the thing is, the stuff came to the Earth's surface because the upper parts became just eroded, and then you can walk around and hammer with all these samples. So, the next thing what you will do, that is, you have your rock samples and then you are making synthesis, yeah? I will next week start with you to give you the introduction in microscope, yeah? So, that is then, for example, one of these rocks, how it looks like under the microscope. So and here we have the mineral garnet, yeah, you know the garnet by now, I gave you the formulas. We have the quartz here, here you have clinopyroxene, here you have plagioclase, and here you have amphibole, and this amphibole was formed later. So you have to distinguish in thin section which minerals are formed earlier and which minerals has been formed later. So in the amphibole, that is a hydrous mineral, and that is then formed at lower pressure and temperature condition compared here to the clinopyroxene and the garnet, yeah? So and here one can see it, this amphibole is overgrown the clinopyroxene. So and then you have these thin sections, and you have identified your mineralite, and the next thing is you are going to a microprobe. And with a microprobe, you can measure the mineral chemical composition of your minerals, yeah? And then you can do some thermodynamic calculations.
We will also do in class very simple ones.
And then you are using thermometer, yes, such a curve, such a steep curve, that is a thermometer, because there you can identify very nicely the temperature when your rock was formed. And you are using barometers, these are some other reactions. And there where there is where you have the corner, where you have this point, I mean there all the three lines are crossing. This is then the pressure and the temperature where your rocks has been formed, yeah? So in these rocks has been formed at a pressure of about 30 kilobars and temperatures ranging between 750 and 800 degrees Celsius. So and this is just the location here from the alumosilicates, that's the kyanite, the andalusite, and the sillimanite. So then we have here some other reaction that is now how it looks like under the microprobe. Here we can see that we are forming a rim of a garment around the monopyroxene. Yeah? That is a feature which is actually typical for isobaric cooling. So we are talking about isobaric cooling and isothermal decompression. So we have here two PD passes. Then we can have such a one. So, and that is a clockwise PD pass. And we can have such a one that is an anti-clockwise PD pass. So, in this part, that is the peak metamorphic conditions here. Somewhere here, here we have the high pressure phase, here we have the high temperature phase. So, in this part from here to here, that is the isothermal decompression. So in this part here, from here to here, that is the isobaric cooling. And here we have the isothermal decompression. So and here on this side, we have the prograde metamorphism. And on this side, we have retrograde. So and on this path we have here prograde metamorphism and here we have retrograde metamorphism. So in this garnet, if the garnet grows around an autopyroxene, that is for example a sign for isobaric cooling. So, but isobaric cooling you will not have in the continent-continent region. So, but these rocks are of different age. So, and therefore, one has always to date and first all this stuff that one knows
at which time certain mineral reaction has taken place. If I'm doing here for that the PT conditions, then I'm getting much lower temperature and pressure conditions as before. So that means from this point of view, you have the high pressure, high temperature condition here, and this point that was then somewhere here, and then we would have such a heating pass. But in the same thin section, one I could observe that the scarlet becomes consumed, yeah? So that means this garnet corona, how we are calling it, when the garnet grows around the autopyroxene, was formed in an earlier stage. So, and therefore, we are consuming the garnet in this sample, and then we are running along such a path. But anyway, what you should have now in mind, one has to check the seed section, you have to check the microtextures in the seed section to make some assumptions about the history of such a rock. Yeah, that is the thing. So, and if you have the history of such a rock, then we can move around our continents. So then we have here another rock sample. And here we have the kyanite inside, we have garnet, quartz, biotite, plagioclase, and here we have ilmenite. So at this rock sample, the rock sample before that was an intermediate rock. So at the protolite of the rock sample before that was an inchless rock. So at the protolite of this rock sample, that is a p-lite, and that means this rock is now a metamorphosed sediment. Yeah? So in the metamorphosed aluminium rich sediment, and it is aluminium rich because of the kyanite, that is then called the metapillite. So, but during metamorphism, minerals are growing, yeah? So when they are growing from the center to the rim, yeah? Not the other way around. It's always growing from center to the rim. So, and then you can make microprobe measurements here from the center and here from the rim. So because this garnet will change the chemical composition from core to the rim. So, and I gave you in class, for example, the four end members of the garnet, yeah? And if we are increasing the temperature, then this garnet becomes more rich in magnesium from core to the rim. And if you are increasing the pressure, then this garnet becomes more rich in calcium from core to the rim. So, but if you are decreasing the pressure and the temperature, then the garnet is in the center more magnesium rich and more iron rich at the rim. So, and therefore one has to do these measurements to understand this history. So, and this is, for example, the temperature and pressure condition for the cores, that is here, yeah? There we have a high pyrope component. So, and that is the PT diagram for the rim. So, and then we have a decrease from in the pressure from core to the rim of about 3 kilobars. And if we are talking about 3 kilobars, then we have lifted up this rock sample 9 kilometers. So then another example that's also from a metapila. We have here again a garnet. So and then this garnet is rimmed by plagioclase. So and if a garnet is rimmed by plagioclase, that means that it's a sign for isothermal decompression. It's from here to here. So, and then one have to do again core measurements and plagioclase measurements outside in the core, then measurements here at the rim of the garnet and the plagioclase rim. So, and then this garnet has also inclusions inside.
inclusions of other minerals, yeah? So and these inclusions became enclosed into the garnet while the garnet was growing, yeah? And it grows from core to the rim.
And there you should become the other temperature conditions,
other temperature and pressure conditions. Here again for the rim for the core compositions, and here again for the rim compositions. Yeah. So one have exactly to check where you have to do or where you like to do your measurements, and therefore a very solid microscopic work before is necessary.
Here, for example, you can also measure with such a microprobe through one garnet crystal.
So, and that is a rim, and that is the rim from the garnet, and here the garnet is in contact with the plagioclase, and here the garnet is in contact with the biotite. So, that is all very important while you are doing geothermal barometry.
So that is now an inclusion in garnets, how it looks like in detail.
Here you have plagioclase inclusion, here you have a kyanite inclusion, a plagioclase inclusion, a K-feldspar inclusion, a biotite inclusion. So if these inclusions are in the center of the garnet, yeah, that brings you now or tells you now something about the highest temperatures and pressures which you can report, yeah?
And indeed,
I got for this sample then nearly 800 degrees, and here we have nearly 12 kilobars, so that means this sample tells you then something about the high temperature phase here, yeah? So and here we have then just the calculation which I have done using the ring composition. So I mean here you have, I used here for the barometer you are using the calcium concentration in the garnet, and for the thermometer you are using magnesium. So and the same for the plagioclases, for the you are using then the anorthite, anorthite composition, but at the high temperature phase, at high temperatures, your plagioclase is more rich in anorthite, and at high pressures, your plagioclase is more rich in albite. Yeah? I used here also the biotite, and the biotite which is formed at high temperatures is more rich in magnesium, whereas a biotite which is formed at lower temperatures is more rich in iron.
So here we have another nice thin section, and there we can see how the garnet reacting away.
So garnet is reacting away and replaced by alumosilicate, a plagioclase and biotite. If the garnet is reacting away, that is also a sign for isothermal decompression along the retrograde PD pass or the clockwise PD pass.
So, and this is recorded in the lowest pressures what I have from my measurements, from my samples.
So, because that is just when the garnet is reacting away, yeah?
So and here,
I have here this stroke line, and this stroke line here that marks just the outline from the former garnet. In this sample, the garnet is totally nearly totally reacted away. Here is a remnant left. And here that is the outline, we have here quartz, biotite, and plagioclase.
So then we have here another silencing section, and need we do this also in the practical. Here we have some, we can observe in thin section, two alunosilicates, the kyanite and the sillimanite, yeah? And I don't know if he has shown you by now the diagram of the kyanite and the sillimanite, but we will do it also in class. That is something like this, kyanite, sillimanite. Under this side, these are the three alunosilicates. So and here in seed section, we have the kyanite and we have the sillimanite. That means we are running around somewhere here on this line, yeah? Otherwise, they would not be together in one sub. So and here we have how mica overgrows kyanite. So that is a reaction, and this reaction is a very late reaction, because if we have mica, and this mica is a mastoid, overgrows kyanite, that means we are adding water to the system, and that is then during the uplift. So then you can do there some triangle calculations, there are computer programs that you can calculate which minerals can be stable under which pressure and temperature conditions, and all these minerals have a certain composition while they are together in equilibrium. So you can have at the same pressure and the same temperature, you can have a rock which contains kyanite, then a phlogopite with an XMG of 68, and a garnet which has a pyrope component of 0.21. Or you can have a rock containing enstatite, phlogopite, garnet, or this one here, yeah? So we will do this also later. I will show you some of these triangles, and there you can then find different stability fields at the same pressure and temperature for different minerals, yeah? And then I have done just this calculation for all these pressures and temperatures, what I got for peak metamorphic conditions. So then one has to take care about the fluid. This is just the general diagram. We have most in most of our rocks we have volatiles. I told you this several times before. And these volatiles usually a mixture of water and CO2. On this side, in this diagram, we have plagioclase, CPX, autopyroxenic garnet, and here we have migmatites. So migmatites is just the molten metamorphic. So then one can calculate so-called PD pseudo sections. Yeah, one cannot see this very well here, but here you have a different stability fields in PD space, and in these different stability fields, you have different stable mineral phases. So and I saw that Neil has already done the Schreine markers with you. He was actually not supposed to do this because I would like to explain it at first in class. But anyway, in your Schreine markers diagram, you have always an invariant point, yeah? So and such a phase diagram contains then or consists a lot of invariant points, and therefore you are making these Schreine marker diagrams to construct at the end such a PD diagram over the whole PD space. By constructing such a PD diagram, you have to know the composition of the fluid. So because I showed you just before in class that when a rock melts, then it will melt much earlier if you have a high fluid
if you have water saturation or less, or a mixture of water and CO2, and, yeah? So, and therefore, to calculate this, you are looking for fluid inclusions. So, fluid inclusions, these are just liquid inclusion enclosed in your mineral vials. So, and you can see them under the microscope, and I will show them to you then under the microscope, because they are swizzling. So, and here we have fluid inclusion containing of water and CO2. Here as well, water and CO2, and here you have such a fluid inclusion, and such water and CO2 fluid inclusion. That is such a fluid inclusion, and there is a bubble inside, and this bubble is moving. So the bubble is CO2, and that is water. So, and then if your fluid inclusion is more rich in CO2, then the bubble is bigger, yeah? So, and then you are using a heating freezing stage, then you can freeze your fluid inclusion. Then you can freeze your fluid inclusion, and then you can heat up your fluid inclusion, and then you can figure out when the whole thing is no longer liquid, then it becomes steam. So and there you can then calculate the pressure and the temperature when your fluid inclusion becomes enclosed during the formation of the mineral, yeah? So anyway, then you are getting some information about the fluid, and this you can get about using the fluid inclusions. Putting all these informations together, then you can construct a PT pass, and that was the PT pass which I have constructed for Tanzania, or for some rock units in Tanzania. That is a clockwise PT pass, which shows isothermal decompression. And here I have already put the age, and this rock has been formed at 640 million years ago. So 640 million years ago, that was then the metamorphic event. But if we are talking about metamorphic events, and if we are talking about the rock cycle, then we know that all metamorphic rocks had been before another rock, yeah? That could be an igneous rock or a sediment. So now that was the next part. Now I'll have to figure out how old this is. And in Tanzania, the rocks are showing the same age distribution like these three elephants. And one see this that is an elephant. This femur is not good, but one can see. These are elephants like they are standing everywhere around. Here we have a mama elephant, yeah, that is the biggest one, and therefore it is the oldest elephant. Then we have here a medium-sized elephant, that is maybe the son or the daughter, I don't know. I haven't checked them so carefully. So, but it's medium-sized, and then it means it's younger than this one, and older than this one, because this one is the baby elephant, yeah? So, and that means we have now three types or three different age categories which I found there, and that I plotted just in this diagram. I have by now even much more ages, but you have here the age, of course, something about 640, 637, 633. Then we have ages scattering around between 1,800 and 2,000. These are the Paleoproterozoic ages. And then we have some very old ages up to nearly 3,000 billion years. And these ages are scattering between 2,500 and 3,000 billion years. Yeah? These are our Archean ages. That means
and then they are scattering also within. Yeah? So in the beads we had at that time, a lot of small fragments. Yeah, we have a lot of small fragments of Archean ages, we have a lot of small fragments of Paleoproterozoic ages, and these fragments collided then sometimes. So when they collided much later, and about 640 million years ago, that was the metamorphism. Going now back to Fiji. At Fiji we have now the situation that we have a lot of small lakes. Yeah? These are all these islands. So and they are just formed now. I mean, here Vitinevo is 49 million years old. Yeah, that is nothing compared to this stuff. So when we have the form, of course, some of the islands are sinking now, but new ones are formed. Yeah? So when this formation process is still, the formation of new material is here still in process. So we have now formed some islands 40 million years ago, some maybe 6 million years ago, and say in the next 50 million years or 40 million years, we will form another bunch of islands, yeah? Because we have here a high degree of magmatic activity, and that you can best see in Vanua Levu, here in Viti Levu as well, because you have here everywhere the salt springs, yeah? So and that is a sign for magmatic activity. And now, in 50 million years, here Viti Levu will collide with Australia, because it's moving towards Australia, yeah? And then Australia is moving then to the north, and then it will collide with Indonesia and with Papua New Guinea till it crashes finally into China. So, and then we have formed from a lot of other smaller plates, we have then formed then the big one, yeah? So, and that is just the supercontinent cycle. And this one can see here also, and this supercontinent cycle is always becomes always repeated, and that is an average every 450 million years. Then the plates crashing into each other, and afterwards they will become separated again. So now we have here such a zircon, and zircon, these are these minerals which I'm using to date rocks. So because I told you just before there's uranium inside, and then you can measure the decay from uranium to lead. And that is a typical metamorphic serpent, because metamorphic serpents are always these roundish balls. So and then you can crush the rock, and then you can pick all these grains, and then you can use a technique which is called COBRA technique, that is a mass spectrometer. And then you are putting all your grains inside the spectrometer, and then you are heating it up. Usually you are heating them up to 1600 degrees Celsius, 1800 degrees Celsius, because then the zircon will just burn away, and then I can count with the mass spectrometer all the atoms running through. So and then I have the number of the atoms of the uranium and the lead, and here I have counted uranium 207 and lead 207 and lead 206, and then I can calculate the age using this relationship, and there I got then the age of about 640 million years, and this is then made from a metamorphic circle. So and then I know high-grade metamorphism has taken 640 million years ago. You can also use some other minerals to date rocks, like garnet, antimony, sphalerite, but then you are getting always different ages, because all these minerals are formed at different temperatures. So when, if you, for example, are dating an amphibole or a biotite, then you are getting a lower age, because the amphibole in this case was formed later, yeah? So and the zircon is a mineral which is formed at very high temperatures, and therefore I'm getting then really the high the peak metamorphic event. But some other minerals, or this is also a zircon, and this zircon is salt. So that means the core is much older than the rim, because the rim has been grown later. So, and there I used another technique, because if I'm putting this zircon grain in such a spectrometer and burning it away, then I get just the average age. Yeah? You can do this only for homogeneous grains. Therefore, you have to use, for example, the shrimp. And the shrimp, that is a sensitive, high-resolution iron microprobe, and there you can just burn holes in your zircon, and then you can measure different the uranium and the lead concentration and on different spots. So, and indeed, that is a Concordia diagram, and for the core of this zircon, I got an age of about 2,500 million years, 2,650, and the rim was grown 630 million years ago. So that means the rim is for the represent the metamorphic age, that means the age when our plates had collided, and the core represents the age of the formation of the magmatic precursor. So, and that you can do then with different, using different zircons. And here I have drawn the shape of the different zircons and of the different phases, why it was grown. And there we have then recrystallized, newly grown domains. And we have the original or ideal zircon. And then you can just measure in spots here. Yeah? And then you are getting the different ages. Here the age for the core, for example, here we have another zircon grain, yeah, you have also recrystallized the newly grown domains, and here you have the original magmatic zircon. So, and then we are getting for this sample then, for the core 2,680. And the rim is 2,633. So we have here now a difference of 50 million years. That means at this time, and 50 million years, if we are looking at these ages here, 50 million years looks like as a small derivation. But if you are looking now at Fiji, I mean, in Fiji, the whole island was formed 49 million years ago, I mean here with 11, yeah? So, but we have also different ages, we have also dated younger ages here in with 11. That means we have the fractionation of a magma chamber that is advancing, or we can have also the situation that different plumes intruding into each other, yes? Like an injection. So, and that is the nice thing in geology, there is a lot of freedom for creativity and for fantasy, yeah? So, but at the end, one is getting then always all this data, and then one has to get a picture or making a story out of it, yeah? So, in this story, one has then to write down and publishing it, and that is the thing what I'm actually doing the whole day. So here we have then a relics of a xenocryst here. So a xenocryst, that is just an older zircon which has been inherited in a newly grown zircon. So, and there are some people saying, going now back to Fiji, that they found here in Vitu Levo, xenocrysts in such a circuit, which are 1,200 million years old. Now the question is, if this is true, yes, then where does this material come from, yeah?
I mean, that has to just pick up somewhere in the Earth's mantle, but then you have to have crustal material here. Yeah? Or it, maybe it was just a bad measurement. Yeah? Because I have now also measured a lot of circles here from Fiji, and I could not only find one xenocrist.
So, but anyway, here we have this xenocrist, and then the newly grown domains. So, and the newly grown domains are 2,630 million years old, and the xenocrist is 2,771 million years old.
That means, if you have a xenocrist somewhere, then this grain must come from somewhere, and that means we had before older material which has been weathered, yeah, because you can only pick up by weathering or erosion, yeah, such a xenocrist out of the rock. And it has been recycled again back into the mantle.
Then we have here another circle. It shows some inclusion inside. It's probably a rutile. So, and this circle shows another age, or is represent another age, and this age is 1,870 million years,
and that is then another group of fragments which were around and later on metamorphosed. So, and here we are dealing with Paleoproterozoic ages.
So, and here we have the last circle from this presentation. It's also a rounded circle, means a metamorphic grain. And this metamorphic grain is 1,925 million years old. That means we had during this time, during the Paleoproterozoic age era, we had also a metamorphic event. So, and that is free will. So, and then I have here this just a summary of the conclusions. We have here this conclusion that large parts of the Mozambique Belt consisted of Archean and Paleoproterozoic material, yeah? That is this conclusion what I got from the ages, which has been reworked, and reworked means we have a metamorphic event during the Pan-African orogen. So then the next one, various age techniques, date the peak metamorphic granulate facies metamorphism at 640 MA. Then we have locally high-grade metamorphic event at about 1,900 million years ago. Then we have this clockwise PT pass, with peak metamorphic conditions of about 13.5 kilobar and peak metamorphic temperatures of about 800 degrees Celsius. And what else do we have? Yes, that is formation of these granulites. We have there a passage of CO2-rich fluids. So, and that is the way how one is doing this. So, and so that you are getting now a little bit an overview, yeah? So, and while we are running then around on Koro, yes, we are also sampling all these rocks, then one have to describe them, then one have to locate them in a map where they are coming from, and this you are putting in your field book. So, and then you have, the first thing is one make then a colorful map, and that was the newer part. And then one have to make the scene sections. I have now a bunch of scene sections also from Koro and from other ultramafic rocks. With those we will start in our microscopic work, with our microscopic work. Then one have to describe this, what you see in the scene section. And then one have to do all these petrological and geochemical measurements, and then one can reconstruct the history. So, and I mean this play here that is just for academic purpose, yeah? So, but it has also an use in the normal world, yeah? And that is, for example, if you are looking for ore deposits, yeah?
I mean, if you are looking for ore deposits, it's always this game, yeah? Because, I mean, it doesn't matter if you are making this story for minerals like garnets or clinopyroxene, or if you are making it for copper or gold bearing minerals, yeah? So but the thing is,
you are always starting from macro scale and then you are going into micro scale. And all minerals are not occurring in such large concentrations, yeah?
I mean, there's only a few gram always.
A few gram per ton, yeah?
So, and therefore, you are using then the rock-forming minerals, like all these minerals, and then you can make assumptions and suggestions if there is a proper, or if there could be a certain ore deposit related to.
So yeah, that was it for today.